And welcome to this Ignite webcast. My name is Josh Topal and I'm a program manager for Office 365. Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners, and this Ignite webcast will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are beneficial to anyone who wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today, we're happy to have Lauren Strandt and a lot of members of our Office 365 support team here to lead us as we discuss real-world deployment scenarios. So Lauren Strandt is director and co-founder at Paradigm and is an Office 365 MVP and VTSP. He also leads the Australian marketplace with the most deployments, so this makes him a great speaker with tons of experience on today's topic of real-world deployment scenarios. So today's webcast will be about an hour, and we're going to leave 10 to 15 minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. So we're recording today's session, and we'll have the slideshow and video available online on the original Ignite blog post and the Office 365 community blog, as well as the video recording that will be up on the Office 365 YouTube channel. So you can find all three of those resources right there, where I just pasted. So one last thing is that if you want to ask questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box below on the bottom left, and we'll try to get to all of them, like I said, during the 10 to 15 minute Q&A at the end of the presentation. So Lauren, whenever you're ready, take it away.
Thanks, Josh, and thank you to everyone for attending from wherever in the world you are. I respect that there's a lot of different time zones at play at the moment. For me, it's a lovely 9:02 a.m. here on a nice cool day in Melbourne, not Sydney, as you see in the picture there. So I'm hoping that the content I'm about to present will be very useful for most of you, so that you've really made the most of your time, whether you're getting up early or staying up late to attend. So as Josh said, I'll be presenting on real-world deployment scenarios. I've got about 13 slides, about 10 to 12 slides of content to go through. Now, it's not all going to be drip and drab. I'll be talking about some actual practical experiences and things that we've seen with customers. So you can get the most out of it. It's not just all straight out labs or best practice documentation. So first thing I'm going to cover is who am I, and kind of expand a bit upon what Josh said. Go through some of the different customer types and scenarios that are out there, what the different mail systems are that we can expect to see, and go through a few of the different solution permutations, really kind of solidifying the fact that there is no one right way for every single customer, and then going through some practical reasons why you would choose particular migration approaches. So without further ado, that's me there looking rather, I don't know if you would say coy, unhappy, happy, whatever. I have been doing Office 365 since the product was launched and before so with BPOS. I've actually written a book on Exchange Online implementation and migration, and I do a fair bit of blogging at thecloudmouth.com. So as Josh said, I'm the co-founder of Paradigm, which is a professional services company in Australia, which has done the most Office 365 deployments, as well as a lot of the most notable ones when it comes to brand names in Australia. And I'm also founded a small company called Extranet, which writes, the other way to describe it is software widgets for Office 365, bits and pieces that I kind of see that wouldn't it be nice if this could happen, so we write a piece of software for it. Some of those are free, some of those are paid, so if you have an opportunity, head over and have a look. There's a few very nice nifty ones, especially around link federation and contacts, which is one of my particular passions. So I'll be drawing on the experiences that I've had with Paradigm for close to 3 years. So Paradigm, as I said, is an Australian professional services company that focuses on Office 365 and cloud services. We're actually the first in Australia to deploy Office 365 both for commercial licenses at the day of launch and also education. So we were doing a fair few schools, but we also did the first school in Australia about 6 months before the product was launched. We've done over 170 deployments around Australia, as well as a few in the US, UK, New Zealand, and most recently Japan. That one posed the most challenges when it came to ordering licenses, because I don't speak Japanese. But that's where Bing Translate came in very, very handy. We've also been a Microsoft Award Partner Award, Microsoft Australia Partner Award finalist for online services for 2011 and 2012. And we're hoping third time lucky we'll win this year. So some of the scenarios, some of the different customer types and scenarios that we see out there really vary. There's really no one way to categorize them, because while there might be things like the Office 365 for small business and professionals, it doesn't necessarily mean that that particular product suits small business and professionals. For example, Paradigm has numerous customers that really only have one or two staff that are actually using the Eagle license suite because of various reasons. So some of the different customers that that we see are micro businesses, so anywhere from, you know, 1 to 5 people generally working from home, or maybe out on the road, but basically a small team of people that just want to collaborate better. Single office, so people that have all going to the one location, generally work from there, don't really travel much, or maybe have a few people that go out to meetings, but have everything in one office. And that might be also big companies as well that have everybody sitting in the one building or the one floor. Then we've got obviously large organisations that may have multiple offices around various cities around the world. To give you an example, one of our customers has an office in sunny Queensland here, as well as several users in the UK. One of the customers as well that we're deploying, even though they're an Australian-based company, has the majority of its users over in the US and the UK. So, you know, when it comes to those type of scenarios, we need to look at them differently from how we would look at a single office type scenario. There's also organisations that have either small or large amounts of people who never hit the office. So how do we deploy those? How do we get to those computers? And what type of technology and collaboration are those people requiring in order to do their jobs out in the field better? And that could be anything from, you know, field workers who need mobile devices and need apps via SharePoint, through to actually people who sit on email all day and just need Outlook to work wherever they are and whatever device they're on. We've also got customers that will have, you know, traditionally on-premises infrastructure, but what we're also starting to see is many customers that are already in the cloud. They may have either like a hosted exchange platform or be using IMAP or POP3, but have effectively built themselves already in, or moved themselves to a point where they have no on-premises infrastructure, but still want to move to Office 365, so how do we address that? One of the more challenging ones that we see are probably the last two, which is where we have legacy platforms that require several steps before we can get them to Office 365. And the, I'd probably say the most fun ones are where we have privacy concerns. So despite Microsoft providing a plethora of material and adhering to standards that most organisations couldn't afford to adhere to, what we still see is many customers just don't trust the cloud or don't trust the public cloud. So there might be a reason, or even if they do trust the cloud, they may be hampered by certain legislations or rules, regulations, from head office, from suppliers, that will hamper them moving completely to the cloud. So what I'm going to go through is, I guess, what different scenarios that would be applicable here in terms of Office 365, because as I said, there is no one-size-fits-all. So this is a bit of an old deck that we've got. So some of the customer mail systems that we've migrated customers for are pretty much everything you can think of. So we've done every version of Exchange Server. We've actually also done an Exchange Server 2000, but that wasn't the stock standard approach. We've done Google Apps with a lot of pleasure. Group-wise, hosted exchanges always throws in the challenges in. I'll explain why. IMAP is relatively straightforward. Kerio is, if anybody's never heard of Kerio, relatively popular, but try to replicate Exchange functionality, but for a different price point. And It does more than IMAP, but less than Exchange, and it does it in different ways. So that's always a fun one. Linux servers, we still do see a fair few of those. POP3 are generally more common among small businesses. That being said, we have seen a few large organizations that still use things like POP connectors to come into Exchange. And then, of course, Small Business Server 2003, 8 and 11, which obviously builds on top of Exchange Server 2003, 7 and 10. So really building on that point of there is no one-size-fits-all, is the fact that it really comes down to what the organization or what the customer is trying to achieve by moving to Office 365, is what actually gives them the, what actually gives us the deployment approach. So, for example, we've got some customers who have had an Exchange Server 2003, or if you look a little bit further, Small Business Server 2003, that simply want to move completely to the cloud. So they just go for an online ID and they do a cutover migration. So one way, no looking back, let's just get on with it. Whereas we've got other organizations, for example, that have Exchange 2003, 7 and 10 and will want to use, as you can see there, any permutation there of DirSync plus a stage migration or a hybrid migration or add ADFS for single sign-on. Adding on a hybrid, and we have done a few hybrids with Exchange Server 2003 and 2007, which also adds some more fun. One permutation that we have done recently is a school that actually had two Exchange 2007 servers that wanted ADFS and single sign-on, but wanted to do a complete cutover migration. So while that's actually not directly available with using DirSync, we have to go with a staged migration approach. We simply staged it in a manner that it was similar to a cutover style migration. And I'll get into what these actually are shortly. With Small Business Server 2003, 8 and 11, the general approach that we go for is a lot simpler in that it's a cutover migration style. So as I said, it's moving to the cloud one way, no looking back. A staged migration is possible with directory synchronization. However, when looking at that, you kind of have to look at why do you need directory synchronization. Given that a small business server is generally limited to 75 users and that organization may be wanting to move to the cloud to avoid on-premises infrastructure, so why is it that they would want to implement directory synchronization? I have seen the question previously, what about single sign-on? And again, you know, these types of, you know, directory synchronization requires a member server that can't be a domain controller. So if you're running Small Business Server 2003, 8 or 11, you need to have another server that's just doing directory sync. If we're using Active Directory Federation services, again, we're, you know, we're starting to get into territory where what's the point of implementing all this complex infrastructure if we're actually trying to move to the cloud in the first place. A valid reason, however, for doing that, as we've actually done in the last few months, was an organization that was actually about 150 users and had grossly exceeded their license limitations and physical limitations of their small business server. They were actually running a 2003 and they actually were moving to higher-end infrastructure and wanted to actually have Active Directory Federation services, but they wanted to do a single migration to the cloud. So that was a little bit more complex, and we weren't able to follow the traditional approach that we would do for a migration, and I'll come into what that looked like a little bit later. Google Apps is generally my favorite type of migration, and quite often actually the simplest, but that comes down to the organization size. So a small business will generally be a simple migration. Larger Google Apps deployments will potentially have a single sign-on solutions in place, and that becomes more complex. But what we generally do for a Google Apps migration is use a third-party migration tool, because while we can connect to Google Apps with IMAP and use the built-in tool, that won't bring across a lot of the other fields. That will pretty much just bring across any mail folders, won't bring across any contacts, calendar, and those kind of things. And there is also, thank you, Ben, there is, I'll address that one shortly, another alternative is hosted Exchange, and that comes down to It depends on what the actual hosted exchange environment is. So for some organizations, they may have a dedicated exchange server that they have admin rights to, in which case we can treat that as a normal type of migration from exchange server, whereas others, it is simply a kind of relatively similar to Exchange Online, where it's a software as a service platform. They have a branded interface where they go in and create users, and there's actually no access to the server. And in that case, we have different migration styles. Others, which is where things like Lotus Notes may fall into, and GroupWise and those kind of things, it really depends on what the organization is looking for. For example, there are third-party tools that will allow you to do a migration from Lotus Notes. By the same token, there's another third-party application that allows you to do a coexistence with Lotus Notes if you're doing a more staged approach or a pilot group first. So the choices to implement directory sync, no directory sync, third-party migration tools, ADFS, use the built-in tools are really subjective to what the customer environment is and what they're trying to achieve as part of their migration. So as I said, there is really no one-size-fits-all. There are best practices, but it really comes down to the specific requirements of the organization. So I guess looking at when we would want to perform a cutover migration. So as I said, a cutover migration is effectively a one-way migration. We're not going back from this one. We can, but it is traditionally used for we are moving to the cloud and we don't care for staging this, doing a hybrid, doing a pilot. We just want to move forward. So it's traditionally used for doing a one-way migration of Exchange Server 2003, 7, and 10, which is also rolls up to 2003, 8, and 2011. In these type of deployments, we don't use directory sync. We create the users online, and what actually happens is once we connect the Exchange Server to Exchange Online, it actually starts migrating the users and does a mailbox synchronization every 24 hours until the mailbox is completed. So the reason it does that is because not every migration is going to take less than 24 hours to happen, and we also want users to keep using their mailbox while they're live. So because it's not a hybrid or a coexistence type model, we can't really switch people into online mode because not everybody is there. So and not all the mailboxes have been activated yet. So what this will do is as it's moving content, when it hits the 24-hour period, it will sync everybody's mailbox, so any changes that they've made locally will synchronize to their Exchange Online mailbox so that when they actually get to configuring their Outlook or Outlook Web Access or mobile device, that anything that they've done has been synchronized up. This is very useful for when customers have limited bandwidth, and as such, it'll be a slow migration or a large amount of users. So, for example, we've got one customer that has been migrating now in cutover migration style for about 11 days, and it's stuck on a few mailboxes that are very large, and the customer has a very small amount of bandwidth. So, as such, it's just synchronizing everybody's mail every 24 hours, and then when that's completed, then we'll cut over the MX record and to point to Exchange Online, and then they'll reconfigure all their Outlooks and have that going. One of the implications of doing a cutover migration is that when you reconfigure Outlook, it will rebuild the OST file because the Office client does not know that that's the same mailbox. While everything looks the same, the user, the email address, all those kind of things, it's a different Exchange server. So the moment it connects, it will pull down a new mailbox or all the content and rebuild a new OST file. So something to bear in mind when doing these type of migrations is what goes up comes straight back down. So bear that in mind when it comes to bandwidth utilization and also downloads. So if you pull 50 gigabytes up to Exchange Online, when you reconfigure Outlook, they're coming back down. This is a perfect type of migration for SMBs who are aiming at reducing on-premises infrastructure and want to get to the cloud as quickly as possible. That being said, as I mentioned, there's a school that we're doing, where they have two Exchange 2000 servers, that is doing a cutover style migration, but obviously it works differently, as I'll get to in a moment. But they're going one way, not looking back at all. So the next style that we have is a staged migration. Now this is where we may, for example, have large amounts of users in an Exchange environment, where there are bandwidth considerations, so that we can't exactly move everybody across, or where we want to pilot the service first and not have everybody move to the cloud and no going back. So the way that this works is we actually choose batches of users to go ahead, and that's done via CSV import into Exchange Online. And we simply say, these are the users we want to move next. Exchange Online contacts the Exchange server and says, give me the mailboxes for these people, and moves them across. And it allows you to be able to stop a batch partway through and roll back if you like. So it gives you a lot more flexibility than a cutover migration. But what happens, though, is the MX record is still pointing to your on-premises Exchange server. And what that actually does is forwards any emails that come into that mailbox to the user's email address in Office 365. So everybody would have probably by now seen the customer.onmicrosoft.com address. That's your tenant URL. So, for example, every user, despite having user@customerdomain.com, will also have a user@customer.onmicrosoft.com address. So what happens here is during the stage migration, this actually modifies the AD attributes of that mail-enabled user and points them or forwards everything to user@customer.onmicrosoft.com. As opposed to the cutover migration where everything happens in one hit and all mail is synchronized every 24 hours. Busy during this process so that cloud users will not be able to see on-premises users and vice versa. Because those users haven't been activated yet. So the on-premises users will see cloud users but won't see their free busy. They'll see them in the GAL, but they won't be able to do their lookup, or it won't be live lookup because it'll be looking at old migrations, old mailbox content. So when we want to implement a hybrid, this is a very different kettle of fish from doing a cutover or staged migration, in that there's a lot more work to be done in terms of certificates and Exchange configuration. And the reason why we would want to do this is because, various reasons. One might be that a particular organization has a large concentration of users in one or more locations, so it does not make sense to move everybody to the cloud because of the bandwidth constraints. Other reasons might be that there may be a group of people that have privacy concerns and as such don't want to move to they don't want to move those users to the cloud. Or there may be more custom reasons like integration with third-party solutions such as on-premises voicemail or ERP solutions or something else. So some examples, again, using schools as examples. In Australia, we see that schools are a little bit fearful of cloud, while also some schools are not fearful. So while we have some schools that have gone complete cloud, we have many schools that are simply deploying Office 365 for student mail, but not deploying it for staff mail because they don't see student mail as being needing to be protected as much because the content in there is not important, whereas staff mail is more sensitive because it has information about students in it. So as a result, not so much that they don't trust Microsoft, don't trust the cloud, it's more so that parents are very concerned about the safety of their children's information, so they don't want to move that to the cloud. Other examples if this would be legal firms, financial practices that simply just don't want to move certain mailboxes to the cloud, and that's where a hybrid works very well. An example of the large concentration of users in one or more locations would be a solution where, for example, a particular building has several thousand people in it. you know, the amount of bandwidth required to have every single one of those users in the cloud would be quite substantial. So the organization really comes up to them as to how they want to implement it and whether they want to move all of those users to the cloud or if they want to keep some of them in the cloud, some on premises. It's very, very subjective. The great thing about hybrid is it's really easy to move users to the cloud and back from the cloud. It is really just a right-click and a move mailbox. So it's much simpler. It really gives organizations the flexibility to do what they want and really do the cloud on their terms. So when would we use third-party tools? It's when we have something out of the Exchange realm that adds a bit more complexity to it. So Google Apps would use a third-party tool. Lotus Notes, definitely, GroupWise, definitely. Other mail products, as I mentioned, Carrio before, or there are certain Linux mail servers I've seen that try to emulate Exchange and as such can use Mappy. So we might use third-party tools for those. Something that we've also seen is multi-environment mergers. This is where certain organizations have come together and they have separate Active Directories, or we've seen one where it had it was a merging of three separate medical practices and as three small business servers. So there's no really an easy way to migrate those using the traditional methods of the Exchange Online migration tools. So this is where we use third-party tools to bring those in and give the customer a nice experience as opposed to breaking mail along the way. Another one where we might use third-party tools is a messy Exchange environment. So, for example, the customer that I mentioned earlier that had a small business server 2003 that was grossly past its limitations, for that reason alone, we chose not to actually touch the Exchange server in any way, shape or form, primarily from a liability perspective, which was driven from technical reasons because they had a scenario where every 3 a.m. they would restart the Exchange service because the licensing method of Small Business Service 2003 would stop it. So to avoid that, they used to start it back up again and kept violating licenses for several years. So in that instance, we felt that that would impact the migration and give us a lot of risks. So what we simply chose to do was to use a third-party tool to migrate their mail content out because we used in that instance migration windows because it has great fault handling and it keeps retrying when things don't work. So some of the tools that you would use in these type of scenarios would be Transcend, Quest and migration windows, and I'll get into a bit more of those as we go along. But those tools are generally used for Quest, for example, allows you to do great GroupWise and Lotus Notes migrations. A lot of organizations in Europe use Lotus Notes. A lot of legacy environments, both across Europe and US and even Australia, still use GroupWise. So those organizations may not be ready to just do a Band-Aid style approach to a migration where we just rip it off and away they are in Exchange. They might want to do pilots and staged approaches, and that's where we use things like Quest to set up coexistence between those environments. That being said, we've also done a Lotus Notes to Exchange Online migration using MigrationWiz for an organization that did want to go one way, and we've done the same for GroupWise as well. Transcend is one that we haven't actually used, and there are several others as well out there on the market that we haven't actually had a chance to use yet because we found that MigrationWiz and Quest have generally been sufficient for us. But there's not to say that you definitely have to use those tools. If you find a tool that works for you or you want to write your own tool, then go for that. I think that Metaviz is Metaviz Technologies, who do a SharePoint migration tool. I believe they're actually working on a Exchange, also a mail migration tool similar to MigrationWiz. So some gotchas and tips. my apologies for anybody who's not familiar with the term gotchas. It's something we use in Australia for, you know, issues, things to look out for. If you're doing anything to do with Active Directory, so you're not doing a Google Apps or a IMAP or any type of migration, you're doing something that has, or you're implementing Directory Sync, make sure that Active Directory is healthy. Make sure that the environment is healthy, because if you don't, you will spend a lot of time resolving small issues before you start the migration or during the migration, and something you'll crop up at every step of the way. So it's important to make sure that the environments are clean and healthy before these migrations begin. It sounds a bit negative, but don't expect a smooth migration. That being said, probably 9 out of 10 migrations will be smooth, but it's best to walk in there expecting issues, because that way when you have a nice, simple migration, you'll walk out of it quite happy, and from a profitability side of things, it works out quite nicely because you've spent less time than you expected. And one of the things that I think a lot of people don't realise until they really start getting into more complex deployments is expect small issues to hold you up. And I mean really small issues. Things like a corrupt item in one person's mailbox, or the .NET framework on one person's computer doesn't allow for Link to be installed hypothetically, or the sign-in assistant. We've seen issues, for example, with some organisations where the postmaster mailbox is being redirected at the spam engine level, and as such, we were not able to get their certificates that were being issued by the certificate authority, because when certificates are issued, they either go to hostmaster, postmaster, or webmaster, or admin at, and quite often some systems have these directed to their website, or they might have them directed somewhere else or to a trash, because spammers tend to send to those addresses as well. So those are some things that we've seen hold us up. We've also seen some organisations that have dated Small Business Server 2003 environments, and you're going to see a lot of those out there because it was a very popular platform. We've seen organisations that we simply can't get Outlook Web Access and Outlook Anywhere to work, therefore we can't do an exchange to exchange online migration, and we've had to do PST-based exports and imports, which is really not fun for anybody to do. Something as well to look out for is obviously things like UPNs, the user principal name. We have seen some organisations that have a space in the username, and that obviously requires changing before we can actually move forward with implementing getting them working in Office 365. And that was in a school of 3,500 people, so you can imagine that that small issue, that small little character, caused quite a lot of impact because it required people to reconfigure their Outlooks, their logins on their desktops, their iPads, Windows phones, iPhones, whatever device they had, everything had to be changed. So that was one look at small issue, but really held thing up. We've also seen things like URLs of Outlook Web Access or ISIS servers, TMGs, things like that, incorrect certificates. These little things can tend to hold organisations up for days. In terms of deployment, and really stretch them out. So I guess some pieces of advice around this: always run the Office 365 readiness assessment if you're doing anything to do with Active Directory. If there's going to be directory synchronization, you need to run this tool, because this will examine everything in the network and tell you what to find. It is an absolute must. If you're doing a Google Apps migration, then you don't need to do it. Not as much. It will check desktops and the like. It's something that we recommend running every single time before any type of migration. As I said, unless it's a very small SMB, in which case it's not really that required. Mozdal is your friend. For those of you who don't know what the acronym is, it's the Microsoft Online Services Diagnostic and Logging Support Toolkit. There's a fair few more words in there than there were letters for that acronym. It is your friend. Anytime you have a hiccup, run it. And if you're going to log any support cases, run that before logging a support case, because that's what the support team are going to ask for. before you actually go any further, and it will save you a considerable amount of time because you're actually sharing the configuration, the issues of that environment with them before simply saying, I can't do this. For those of you who, I guess, are relatively new to IT, which I don't think would be many, add buffer time to deployments. No deployment is generally going to be the same. So while you may have one small business server 2003 that took you all of 3 hours to migrate to the cloud and get it all configured, you may come across another one that takes several days. Always add buffer time to deployments, because while the Office 365 environment is uniform and the same for everybody, the issues that affect the migration are not always uniform as well. We have seen unique ones. For example, we have seen an issue with one customer where there was a bug in IIS, in the virtual directory, and that took a month to resolve. So add buffer time, set expectations, and, you know, as I said, don't expect a smooth migration. A very, very, very powerful resource is the Office 365 community site, because Office 365 has been out in the market for a year and a half. There are thousands upon thousands of customers and millions upon millions of users on the service. It would be safe to say that everything has been seen and done before. But what we need to do is ensure that before going and reinventing the wheel, that we see if somebody else has invented it for us. So check the community site, because someone has generally seen the issue before. It's also monitored by Microsoft support staff. So it's a great way to, if you have a, how should I do this, or has anybody seen this, as opposed to an actual support issue, something that's more just a general inquiry. You'll see it there, excuse me. And it's also monitored by people like myself and fellow MVPs and just other fellow community people who want to help out and answer questions and share their information. There's a lot of wikis on there. There's a lot of blog posts. There's a lot of forums. So definitely make sure that at any time you have an issue, even before potentially logging a support case, have a look on the community site, because it's quite possible someone has found that issue beforehand. There's also a lot of good blogs there that people like myself publish to, where we share information and again, you know, you might see something and it's not necessarily affecting you right now, but you might say, oh, that's a good, you know, knowledge-based article, that's a good PowerShell script, I might need that for future. So I guess I've probably finished a little bit ahead of schedule. So were there any questions?
Yeah, while we're waiting for people to type, thanks a lot.